Just as the events of the world and the news is so rapid and astonishing, that the shifts and changes and all that, the play of hope and fear, here also it's quite astonishing, the rapidity by which I'm being liberated from that hope and fear. And that not only I, but the recognition of how to be liberated is also keeping pace with the other stuff, right? The bad stuff, the troublesome stuff, the torment. So some will try to keep up with both. Okay, well, that's their choice. I don't advise that at all. And if they think they're smart enough to do that, they'll find out if they really are. But we don't do that. We don't keep up with the news at all. And there's a reason for that. And by the way, everyone goes through a phase where you try to do both until eventually they see it doesn't work. But we keep thinking, well, it should be able to work. I should be able to. Yeah. And then, so, but the less time you spend in that phase, the better. It's torment. It's torment. And here we're about getting free of torment. That's what we want to do, is get free of torment. So here we go with another video, and it's very rapid. And you might say, well, I just don't want anything that's rapid right now. Well, it's all rapid, right? We're in the rapids. So success belongs to those who simply realize, you know what? Crying about it's not going to help me at all. We're in the rapids. Okay, so now we have to navigate these rapids, plain and simple. It's just like I said to someone, it feels like summer. They say, no. I said, well, you got to jump into how it is. It's spring, but it's really super nice. It feels almost like summer, actually. And you got to jump into it. I say, people look at me and says, wow, look at how you're dressed. I say, yeah, I'm jumping into how it is now. You just got to jump into it. And others are saying, no, I'm not ready for that. No, I don't want that. No, I'm not. That's useless. I mean, you go outside and it is what it is. It's warm. It's almost hot. It's sunny. That's how it is. So it's useless to hit your head against the times, how it is. You just have to embrace the fact that this is how it is, and then I'll say, okay, so I'm going to be going rapid one way or the other. Either rapidly being pulled into massive torment, or rapidly being pulled out of all torment, actually. That's the only choice we have in the world right now. It's the only choice there is. Because it's all intense and rapid now. It's all that way. So those who recognize this are very fortunate indeed. Here, we certainly recognize the need for great rapidity. So I had a dream last night, a dream I never had before. To preface this, I relayed a story about a relative of mine who took this medication that had some sort of allergic reaction to other medication, and they were home alone and they were dying, and they were immobilized and they couldn't breathe and it was horrible, and suddenly they finally surrendered to God. They said, "Okay, God, if it's my time, it's my time. I'm okay with that. There's nothing I can do." They surrendered to death, basically, what they were saying. And suddenly, some force just shoved them up on their feet and said, "Go eat sugar, as much sugar as you can." And so they stumbled into the kitchen and started just eating all the sugar. And what this caused, it caused them to vomit, 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 vomit. And somehow, it saved them. They were brought back to life this way. And they didn't know anything about this, about, you know, how this would work. But it worked to restore them to life. And it was the hand of God for sure. It was the hand of God. Some force just took over their mind and body and said, you got to go do this. You have to go do this. And did exactly the right thing. And so I was just relayed that story last night. And then I went to sleep, and I was dreaming, and suddenly, in the dream, I was walking into the kitchen. I said, okay, I'm going to go into the kitchen now. And suddenly, as I entered the kitchen, it was like I hit this force field or something. I was just jolted. My whole body was just absolutely like pulled out of itself almost. And I couldn't go any further. I was stopped dead in my tracks. All momentum suddenly halted. Wow, was I shaken up. And so what was that? It was almost like my body got pulled out of itself. It was such a jolt. I was so jolted by something. A force jolted me. Totally. And stopped me. So, I have never experienced anything like that. Now, this morning, I'm going through this and say, okay, what happened? And it woke me up, and during the night, I said, I was just kind of in shock. What's going on? Well, I figured it out. That is for sure. And it's the hand of God. Suddenly, God put his hand in front of me and said, stop me. And said, no more of that. No more of that. Wow. How amazing, huh? How amazing. So I was trending towards going back to something I shouldn't go back to. And God said, no, you're not doing that. Stop me. It's great to have help like that, isn't it? Even though it was quite shocking. Quite shocking. But, you know, I'm fine. Nothing's harmed. It's just... it's funny because I've been praying to God. I said, God, prevent me from doing anything I shouldn't do, even if it's kind of shocking to me. The days before, I've been praying that. I said, it's okay. I accept that. If you want to stop me, you can stop me, even if it shakes me up, you know, the way you stop me. That's fine. So that's exactly what God did. Just stopped me dead in my tracks. Then this morning, I was able to focus in beautifully. On Apex Yoga, Apex Wow Yoga. I'm an Apex Yogin, the peace of God is wowing me. This is what we say, I'm an Apex Yogin, the peace of God is wowing me. I'm an Apex Yogin, the peace of God is wowing me. So I'm getting it all clear in my mind what this yoga is. It's fabulous. It's the yoga for these times we're in. It really is. We need a particular approach right now for the rapidity of the world as it's going to hell so fast. We need a particular approach for these times, and this is it. Apex Yoga is this approach. I'm aware of it. And the woodpeckers are out already. All the birds are out. I mean, it's spring here. Birds are just everywhere. They're eating berries. I mean, they're just, you know, it's full on. Full on. Rapidity of spring is here, right? The intensity of that. So Apex Wow Yoga. I'm calling it Apex Wow Yoga. Apex Wow Yoga. Apex Wow Yoga. There is a way for us to truly be helped at this juncture. Truly be helped. So I call this Apex Wow Yoga pre-intensive, so you can get clued into this, begin to adapt, you know, get familiar with the conventions that we use. So I'm working on this Apex Wow Yoga this morning. So I'm pioneering it. It's you know. We're talking about business this morning, how hard it is to run a business, and it's true. I mean, I work around small businesses, and the owner of the small business, really, they're so dedicated. It's a 24/7 thing for them. Sure, they take vacations, but even on vacations, they're constantly calling and checking. I mean, it takes a special person to run a business. It really does. They never punch the clock. 4 o'clock, I'm out of here. Paperwork, so much paperwork, keeping everyone busy, scheduling everything. It's just all consuming, and you know, the family life, you know, suffers. Often they bring the family members into the business so that they can have a life together. It's really, really, really tough to run a business. You have to be so dedicated to it. It's the same thing with this, you know, pioneering this Apex Wow Yoga. You know, I'm on it 24/7. I'm consumed by it 24/7. It never leaves my mind. I'm never planning vacations or taking vacations. If I say, God, if you want to give me a vacation, fine, but I'm not taking any time off to plan for it. I mean, you just have to drop it in my lap, basically. And that's what God has done. It just suddenly, boom, like that. But I never even, you know, my mind is still completely focused on this. And vacation happens, but even then, the whole time, I'm completely focused on this Apex Wow Yoga also. So I never stop focusing on it. And that's what it takes to lead this kind of situation like this, to pioneer it and to make it available and to make it clear what it is. It's a total dedication sort of thing. But this is what, you know, small business people do. I mean, in the family, there's a small business. I can see the dedication that it takes, and I'm around, again, owners of small business. And, you know, I'm very aware of just this relentless determination that they have and commitment. They're really committed to it. So I grew up in that environment to some extent, and I'm that way anyway. So I have lifelong commitment to this. So I can push it through. I can push it through. That's what I do. And lead, follow, or get out of the way is a good mantra to have. Lead, follow, or get out of the way. Many people want the perks of leadership without the absolute dedication, and you can't have that. So for them, they need to get out of the way. Either follow or get out of the way. And you know, it's true. There's a lot of people who pretend like they're interested, but they just want the perks. You know, what can I get from this is what they're thinking. Minimum amount of work and maximum amount of getting from it. So, and they want to be co-leaders or something like that. And of course you have to notice that and say, no, you either lead, you know, lead, follow, or get out of the way. And leadership takes, you know, total dedication and know-how, actually. You can't have everybody leading. You have chaos. So you have, someone has to lead. Someone has to know what it's all about. Be very clear what it's all about. Very dedicated, very clear. keeps everything on track, and the rest have to follow. Now, being a good follower is a tremendous skill, a tremendous skill. That's what I've done my whole life in terms of listening to the gurus. I've been a great follower, a great listener, a great follower. So before you can be a leader, you have to be a great follower. Absolutely. And then that being a great follower just naturally matures into being able to be a leader. You can never desire to be a leader. See, I don't have any desire to be a leader. It's just Longchenpa asked me, said, maybe you can work your way into this. I said, well, you know, I'm not really interested in it, but you know, if that's what happens, fine. I'll just keep working as hard as I can. The best president is one who doesn't desire to be a president. In other words, the best leader is one who does not desire to be a leader at all. It's just that they're such a good follower, they're now capable of training others to be really good followers, right? Yeah, it's like that. I'm just training others to be really good followers. And I'm also really good of staying out of the way, my work that I do. A lot of it is the skill of just staying out of the way. Do what you do and stay out of the way of the rest of the guys who are experts in what they do. They tell me, hey, get out of the way. I'm really good at staying out of the way, really good. And those who are really great workers, they really appreciate it, actually. I was working with someone yesterday, and he's a fabulous worker, like an A++ worker. And most of the time, I just stay out of his way. I'm just a standing on the sidelines. And you know what? It gets done. What needs to get done, gets done. And that's what's important, actually. It's not about me. It's about getting what needs to get done, done. And since he can do it, I just stay out of the way and let him do it. And if he needs something, he'll tell me, can you get me this? And I say, sure. Can you get me this? Sure. And then I just stay out of the way. I don't say, here, let me help you. Let me help. That's the worst, the let me help you syndrome. Because you're trying to get credit for doing something where, in fact, you're only making it more difficult for the one that knows how to do it. So it's lead, follower, stay out of the way. But staying out of the way, you can also be part of it. Because I'm right there seeing what he's doing, benefiting from what he's doing. You see? If he asks for help, then help. If not, then don't help. But stay close to the situation. Lead, follow, or just stay out of the way. Stay out of the way. Don't meddle at all. But this is very difficult. So I've been able to do both of those. Very good at staying out of the way. Very good at following. And so this is what needs to be passed on. And the ones who are great workers, they like having me around because I don't bother them. I don't get in their way. They like that. And if they need help, they just tell me, hey, could you just help me with this? I say, sure. And then as soon as I've done helping, I back off and just stand to the side. And I don't get in their way at all. And they really appreciate that. That's a skill. Now, what we do here is very simple. So, the simplicity has to be recognized. Recognizing the simplicity is following along, and recognizing, continuing to recognize how simple it really is. And here's an analogy. In Buddhism, they say you need to enter the stream, that's the Dharma, and then, you know, work to get to the other side of the stream. But really, Buddha also said that the wise are already on the other side. That's really Dzogchen. That's the highest teaching. They're already on the other side. But here with Apex Wow Yoga, we do it a little differently. We throw in this intermediate step, which is important. Because no one's really that wise right now, okay? Actually, Buddha commented that to his close Sangha, but hardly anyone really got it at all. But he said, if you're really wise, you're already on the other side. He realized he was already on the other side, but the others didn't, you see. So that's the ultimate goal. But in the meantime, So what we do here is we don't try to swim across the river. I mean, I've been trying to swim across the river my whole life. I said, something's wrong. The current keeps sweeping me away and stuff. What do? We go across the bridge. We walk across the bridge is what we do. There's a bridge. And here we are trying to swim across the river. All the while there's this bridge. All you have to do is just walk across the bridge. It's easy. And nobody's ever really brought that up. Hardly. Actually, the gurus have, to their closest devotees. But we don't get it. We haven't gotten it. I finally am getting it now. I'm getting it. So, oh, there's a bridge. Oh, my God. How stupid. I've been trying to swim across that raging torrent the whole time. And there's just this bridge. I just walk across it. It's easy. Wow. It's that easy. And what's the bridge, name of the bridge? Wow is the name of the bridge. So that's apex, wow, yoga. The yoga is to turn your attention to the bridge. And the bridge is wow. And the wow gets you to the apex, which is the peace of God. So apex, wow, yoga. It's a threefold discipline, right? The goal is the peace of God. And we say, I am an apex yogin. The peace of God is resting upon, is wowing me. I am an apex yogin. The peace of God is wowing me. Okay? Because as we walk across this bridge, we begin to feel the peace of God because the easement is there for us. So I'm an apex yogin. The peace of God is wowing me. That's our profession. So we have a profession. We have a name, what we're doing. It's apex wow yoga. Our profession is, I am an apex yogin. The peace of God is wowing me. Really simple. And for great rapidity, you need simplicity, don't you? Because, boom, you can go right to it. You know where the gears are. But so for those who are struggling to cross the river, this is not for them. This is an alternative to that. It's an alternative. So you can't both try to swim across the river and walk across the bridge. How can you do both at the same time? That's ridiculous, isn't it? That's absurdity. That's insanity, actually. And many will say, oh, I'll do both. What does that mean? It means you're in severe confusion. It's like, say, I'll both fly an airplane across the Pacific Ocean to Japan, and I'll also swim across it at the same time. No. Lead, follower, get out of the way. In this case, they have to get out of the way. Get out of the way. But we're stuck in. We keep thinking that even though that's obviously crazy, we don't see it as crazy. Because we're so determined to swim that river. Why? Because we can't swim it. That's why. Because it acts as a barrier to the peace of God. That's why. And so, we feel safe from what we think is wrongly believe is an abyss. Okay, so now we have to get into the teaching. That's part of the yoga. We have the apex, which is the peace of God. That's the goal. The wow really is the bridge. It's a new identity. It's a bridge identity. We have a bridge identity, which is wow. The old identity is the torment of hope and fear. Okay, the torment of hope and fear, trying to fixate the mind, which is impossible. So we only have hope and fear. We hope it's possible, but we constantly are experiencing it's not possible. The fear. Okay, so how do you get free of that hope and fear and step onto the bridge? Because the bridge will take you swiftly over to the peace of God. Swiftly to the peace of God. We don't step on the bridge. Why? Because we don't want that. We think the peace of God is an abyss. We'll fall into an abyss. So, what's the teaching that clarifies this? And it's very simple. Very, very simple. Is what we have been doing with a conditioned existence, perception, conditioned existence, body, world, etc. We're merely hallucinating the absence of God. We're hallucinating the absence of God. God meaning the everywhereness, the completely seamless, smooth, equal everywhereness of intrinsic spaciousness, the ground of being. That aspect of the Trinity, we've been hallucinating the absence of that. And again, hallucinating the absence of something doesn't mean it's absent. But if we're trying to believe, so much believe that it's absent, we're hallucinating the absence of it and then trying to believe in this hallucination, the absence of it. And as such, if we think then the absence of God is reality, then this hallucination becomes our God, doesn't it? And we think this hallucination is protecting us from an abyss. Because if the absence of God is true, and it's hallucination which is holding this in place, if we stop hallucinating, we think there'll be nothing there at all. Nothing there at all. So that's the abyss, the fear of the abyss. So that's why we're trying to swim across this raging torrent of hope and fear. This river, this torrent is really the torment of hope and fear. That's what's generating it. The insecurity of hallucination is generating it. Intrinsically, hallucination always generates insecurity. Always. Which is then defended against by hope and fear. That's exactly what's happening here. It's that simple. And so that's why the fear of the abyss is why we don't step on that bridge. That's all there is. So again, we need to look at hallucination and start seeing this. Say, hey, well, oh, wow, yeah. So if I think hallucinating the absence of something is true and that this hallucination is true, then I got to make sure that I don't drop this hallucination. Otherwise, it won't be anything there at all. And so then we try to fixate the mind. It's the mind that's hallucinating. We know that, so we try to make the mind concretize it, the mind. So that's why we're so focused on what we call concrete mind, you know, labels, numbers, analysis, teaching, learning, concretization, structuring, structures. You know, really into buildings and structures and stuff like that. And anything that fixates. Like I've never been interested in structures, really, you know, buildings and all this stuff, machines. I got no interest in any of that stuff. All that stuff is designed to fixate the mind. Belief that gives us hope that we can fixate the mind so it doesn't drop hallucination, because we think that the absence of God is the new reality, and then if that suddenly disappears, we won't have anything because the God is now gone. You know, we've been hallucinating the absence of God, and we've taken it to mean that God is no more God at all. So if the mind drops hallucination, we think we're going just being dropped into a total abyss of nothingness. This is our fear. Just the opposite happens. When we drop hallucination of the absence of God, then what has been there always, which is the God, the peace of God everywhere, that's what we experience. We experience this complete fullness. Peace of God is everywhere. And it's completely gentle. It's like, oh, this is no trouble at all. What the heck was I so afraid of? That's ridiculous. I was afraid of this? That's ridiculous. And then we might get a little panicky. Say, well, maybe this isn't it, because I must have been afraid of something. But if you recognize the dynamic of hallucination, hallucinating the absence, or even hallucinating something that is there that isn't there, either way, it's insecure. Hallucination is brings inherent insecurity with it, which we inherently defend against through hope and fear. I hope I can do something, fixate this, but I'm afraid I can't because it still feels insecure to me. And then the massive play that happens between those two poles of polarity, all the turmoil comes from hope and fear, actually. The entire ocean of samsaric torture, torment, comes from hope and fear, which is based on trying to fixate hallucination. Plain and simple, the fear of the end, the fear of the abyss, drives this. You know, it. So that's all there is to it. And we need to just look at it exactly as it is, instead of being lost in the details of hope and fear, which are endless. The play of hope and fear, you have to pull yourself out of that. But you can do that instantly by just recognizing hallucination. We're hallucinating the absence of God, and we feel if we drop it, we'll be in the abyss. So we're driven to try and fixate hallucination. Hallucination is just a mental thing we're doing, imagination. But at any instant, we can drop it. Mind's completely free. It can just stop hallucinating the absence of God any instant. We'll always be that way. And this is what terrifies us. We think, oh, God, gosh. So just seeing this root of the trouble, that automatically we realize, oh, I don't have to struggle with hope and fear at all anymore. I don't have to try to figure anything out about hope and fear anymore. So, as soon as you get to this point, you could step on the bridge, the wow bridge. And you're now an apex wow yogin. As soon as you see this, you're an apex wow yogin. And now your focus is getting onto that bridge. Step on the bridge and walk across the bridge. Which now you're being wowed by the peace of God instead of trying to be wowed by hope and fear. Okay, by all the everything that's going on in the world. You're no longer interested in that. So what you do is you surrender the world to the guru or to God. You can either surrender it to God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, the Trinity. So you can say, I surrender it to God, or you can say, I surrender it to the Guru, or you say, I can surrender it to the Holy Spirit or the grace of God. Whichever way you like. It's all the same. You give it all up to them and say, here, it's yours. And you know, if there's anything of value in that, they will give it back to you for sure when you're ready for it, if there is. But they'll be able to determine if there's any value in it. So you just say, I'm done with that. I'm done with the world and everything in the world. And you just surrender it all to the grace of the guru, or God. And you can use any label you're comfortable with. That's okay. But give it to the guru is one way of saying it. Right? Just give it all to the guru. And another step, even more advanced, is you also give up all gurus to just one guru. You surrender all gurus to just one guru. Because surrender all gurus to God. So you're not trying to sort out all the gurus either. You just give everything. Everything, the entire play of conditioned existence, you give it all to God. And you're left with just this empty husk. Like, the ego now is just this rice hull or something, or wheat chaff from wheat, right? Or an empty lantern. Just there, like an empty shell on the beach. That's all it is. Just blowing in the wind. It's still there. You just see this empty husk. Just an empty husk, but there's nothing else there at all. Nothing else there at all. So there's no wow factor. You're not being wowed by the world anymore in any way. But that's okay, because we still have this, we're being wowed by the peace of God. We can realize it's there. We feel this subconsciously. Peace of God is just right there. It's so close. I experienced it just last week. We're wowed by the bridge. We're wowed by this bridge to the peace of God now. We're not wowed by the world at all. We've surrendered the world. So you just surrender the world. All of it. All of it. Even the activity of the gurus here in the world, you surrender all that too. You give it all up. Because our goal is to literally abide in the peace of God, abide in that experiencing. And that will wow us. I'm an apex yogin. The peace of God is wowing me. That is our goal. I am an apex yogin. The peace of God is wowing me. Okay? That's our goal. So we have a very clear goal and nothing else. Nothing else. Apex yoga arising, right? Apex yoga arising. Now, I keep trying to help. Facebook is an insane asylum, actually. And we're all suffering from insanity, aren't we? Thinking that dropping hallucinations in the abyss is insanity. And then the torments that come with this of hope and fear, we're all suffering from that. We've all In all the gurus, they've been there at some point, except the avatars, like Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. But they've all been there. And, you know, I've certainly been there, and I'm still, to some extent, suffering from it. So, yeah, I mean, but the sooner you realize that this, like, wow, something, you know, isn't right. I'm suffering from mental instability, you know, and trying to fixate. I keep this, you know, my complex is wrong. I've got to fix this. There's something wrong with this. I need help from the grace of God. Then the sooner you get free of that. But I've experienced this over and over again on Facebook. It's just amazing. It's a cuckoo's nest. Really a cuckoo's nest. But what do you expect? Everything's a cuckoo's nest. You give them some help and they just spin it off completely, you know. Oh, great, this will help me fixate on the absence of God. Good. I said, no, you're supposed to surrender the all attempt to fixate. It doesn't get through to most. It's just a rare few that it actually, like Jesus said, you scatter seeds everywhere and some fall on rocks, some fall on shallow soil, and some fall on deep soil. And so Christianity is just to scatter the gospel throughout the world and see, you know, wherever it takes root. That's what Jesus told us to do. So, but I scattered, like, you know, I've done that and scattered, and, you know, that's, the bounce back, you know, is pretty interesting. The backwash. This beautiful wave, there's this backwash. It hits the wave, and the wave, whoo, you know, makes it all unstable suddenly. Because as long as people are driven by this fear that of the abyss, they're going to be frantically trying to build boats to get across that river. Of course, it tears the boats apart. They can't get the right materials. You know, they're trying to swim across it. They're trying to find some way. None of them are getting across the river. And then they justify it. So I say, well, yeah, it's going to take me innumerable lifetimes to get across that river. You never can swim across that river. Never can swim across that river. So this needs to be brought to light. Interesting. Can never swim across that river. One side's hope and one side's fear, and the river is the turmoil between the two. But instead of swimming, trying to swim across it, we just take the bridge across it. We surrender the river to God, give it all to God, all hope and fear, all of that, all activity in the world. Whatever it is, I just surrender it completely. I'm empty. You empty yourself of all of that. It's all given to God. You give it to God. Say, here, it's yours. Take it. Everything. Take all my lives, all my future lives, all my past lives, all my future lives. Take everything I will ever do or won't do. And I'm just giving it all to you. Not interested in anymore, actually. And then we cease to be wowed by the world. We cease to be wowed by the world, but that's not an abyss, because we're being wowed by the peace of God. So we still have this bridge identity. There's no abyss. By focusing on a bridge identity, this evaporates the fear of the abyss for you. This is what I've found. It lessens. Peace of God came upon me last week, and I said, wow, this is wonderful. So, it's just so smooth. There's not even a ripple of fear, really. But certainly the fear of the abyss has to be lessened and lessened and lessened and lessened. And you do that by building this bridge identity called the wow identity. Because this wow identity, then we're so used to being wowed that when the peace of God wows us, we say, oh yeah, well, that's, I'm just being wowed. So that's normal. There's no abyss there at all. There's a transitional, see, a bridge is a transitional sort of thing, but it's above what it's bridging, isn't it? So our my reaction and your reaction in Apex Yoga practicing is to get into Apex Yoga, you have to practice wow, full stop in the wow. Whatever arises, your reaction is simply wow, 360 degree wow. That's all that there is. Why is that so important? Because when the peace of God comes upon you, when you're wowed by the peace of God, it's peace of God is completely stable. It's completely equal. It's completely smooth. There's no hope and fear, play of hope and fear at all. So your reaction needs to be this just one reaction, which is just wow. That's why it's so important to have this wow bridge. If you don't have that wow bridge, you'll say, well, how do I react to this? And then you'll get all panicky. Your reactions will just become chaotic and panicky. Because you're looking for structure and inequality and judgment and analysis, and none of that has any play at all there. It's crazy to try to apply that to the peace of God. And then you start feeling you're crazy, or the peace of God is crazy. You'll feel this craziness, like, hey, I can't apply this. I can't get the reactions I want. And you'll think it's an abyss. You'll wrongly believe it's an abyss. So really, those here in this world are believe that the peace of God is an abyss. So they're terrified of it. And so they're desperately trying to find some motivation to do something else and try to tell themselves, well, this is good. God wants me to do this. God wants me to struggle with hope and fear. Not true at all. Not true at all. So we project our troubles and try to say that God wants us to be this way, hoping that, you know, that'll keep us away from the abyss. Believing the peace of God's an abyss, we then have to pray to God to protect us from this abyss. So you get these graduated religions that just, you know, slowly trying to teach you how to swim across the river, and you never get there. But you think, oh, God wants me to do this, and sort of keeps you fixated on it, and you think that's protecting you from the abyss. So we really pray to God to protect us from God is what we're doing in the world. That's why Dzogchen or Apex Yoga points this out about the graduated progressive approaches really never get you there. That's their design. It's designed to prevent you from getting there, actually, but feel self-righteous about doing so. And that's what Jesus said, the same thing. Criticized the Sadducees and the Pharisees because he said what they're really doing, that all the self-righteousness is what they're teaching you is how not to get the peace of God and to feel self-righteous about that, as if that's what God wants them to do. That's what Jesus pointed very, very clearly and directly to that. Speaking from the apex approach. Jesus always spoke from the apex approach, the apex position, which, and the gradualists, the progressivists who are trying to, thinks that the peace of God is an abyss, of course, they distorted all that, what Jesus said. And now you've got this mishmash. Nobody can quite figure out what Jesus said at this point. Same thing with the Buddha. They turned it into... But Buddha, I mean, pragmatically said, look, you're not ready yet, so you got to start disciplining yourself. So build good habits. So Buddha focused on good habits. And Christianity also ended up focusing on good habits. The teachers understand the apex position, of course, but as it plays out among the insane who think the peace of God's an abyss... is you can't just directly, you know, get them there because they're too terrified. So you have to then, what do? Well, you have to start disciplining them so they calm down. The disciplining habits requires you to calm down. You know, all the virtues, they teach all the virtues. Forgiveness, humbleness, meekness, forgiveness, patience, long-suffering, charity, you know, don't lie, don't steal, don't cheat, don't kill, treat everyone, golden rule, you know, all this stuff is designed to make you less industrious on trying to figure out how to block the peace of God. make you less industrious in that. The barbarians, the pagans, are very industrious, aren't they? Super industrious. Whereas those who follow religions are much meeker, they're less industrious. I'm very non-industrious. I've hardly done a thing to the world. Built nothing, done nothing. You know, I'm not industrious at all in structuring the world. But those who are very egoic, very afraid of the peace of God, are super industrious. That plays out in the world right now, but you have two types: the barbarians, who are super industrious, and the self-righteous religious ones, who feel that they have figured out how to permanently avoid the peace of God, that they have like some special way to do it, and then they set up these religions and teachings and whatever, and that's the other part. They're very industrious in thinking that if we just institute this control everywhere of not doing too much, that's it. That's it. So politically, it's the difference between the conservatives and the liberals right now. Of course, both of those are just two different ways of trying to avoid the peace of God. That's all that it is. So Trump's super industrious, for instance. He's a barbarian. He's super industrious. Build, 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 build. Structure, structure, structure. Buildings, buildings, buildings. You know, that's a pagan. He's a pagan. Very industrious. Super industrious. And he thinks that will protect. That's how we protect ourselves from the peace of God. The liberals are super industrious also about having to, controlling everybody to say, let's just have a certain level of industriousness and no more. And that is the answer to fixating hallucination and protecting us from the peace of God. But they're super industrious about controlling people and regulating everybody. They say, we don't want to do too much. We don't want to be too industrious, and we don't want to be too non-industrious either. So it's called the middle point. The liberals are fanatic about trying to reach this middle point, and they think that that will be our fixation, and we can stay there. Of course, it doesn't work. So we oscillate between these two. That's why we have this polarization between the self-righteous religious type, which are really the liberals. Who think they can find this? They think that the middle path is a middle place. It's a complete, total misread of religion. The liberals have misread religion, completely misread it, and they become these Sadducees and Pharisees who say, "No, we know exactly what's right for you." And this, you know, the socialists, Marxists, they'll say, "We'll give you exactly the right amount of everything, right amount of work, right amount of food, right amount of this, and this will fixate us properly." And that'll protect us from the peace of God. Whereas the barbarian says, no, let's just build structure everywhere. More structure this, more structure. Stay constantly busy and working and structuring. That will protect us. So really, they're two sides of the exact same coin. That's why I say, surrender the whole world. It's a world of folly, is all it is. So I'm not, you know, pro-Trump or anti-Trump or anything like that, really. Pragmatically, you don't want either side to gain a stranglehold on the world, okay? You don't want either side, because then it gets really bad. So what I say is you should alternate between conservative and liberal leadership. You should alternate. That's the best we can do in this world. Don't let either one gain a stranglehold. And by alternating, it frees those up who want to go beyond this nonsense. It helps free them up. So I'm really happy that Trump is in power now, because he's pulling it back the other way from the abyss of Sadducee, Pharisee liberalism, of fixating quotas for everything. Quota fixation, as if that's the answer. That's horrible. Okay. So, you know, this it's going balancing back the other way, which is great. And then when that goes too far that way, then I want the liberals to come back and pull it back that way a little bit. You see that? So I'm independent pragmatist. Don't let either side gain a stranglehold. So it's the grace of God that Trump's in power, actually, because we were right on the verge of the liberal fixation approach gaining a stranglehold on the world, and we were so close to that, super close to it. And really, Trump has given us the opportunity to breathe a little bit. So it's a super blessing, actually. But he is a barbarian. I mean, okay, I'm not stupid, you know. Of course he's a barbarian. Totally fixated on structure and form. And the peace of God scares the heck out of him. But he's honest about it. He says, yeah, the religions, he's like, you read the Bible, you pray, that scares me. I want to build stuff. He's like this honest barbarian. Which is good. The world needed an honest barbarian. It really did. And he came along. But a barbarian nonetheless, right? Who feels the peace of God is an abyss. No less than the liberals. The liberals are super barbarians, but they're really super self-righteous barbarians who think they've got religion all figured out, and they think it's fixating on quotas. I mean, if it was up to them, they'd take a Buddhist sangha and say, well, you have to have half has to be barbarians who think you're crazy, and the other half can be, you know, Buddhists, and we have to have equal amount of disbelievers and believers everywhere. Everything has to be completely homogenized. Which is, you know, that causes just this hideous ennui, you know, hideous. And then you go into sex, drugs, and rock and roll to try to treat that. You know, they say, oh, it's great, that's fine. You say, well, that's necessary in our approach. That sure, we're going to suffer this hideous despair, this bottomless despair. But we treat that with sex, drugs, and rock and roll, and that's fine. As long as there's quotas with that too, you know. Yeah, they'll make sure you have to have partners of either sex, you know. And all age groups, and drugs of all different types. I mean, there's no end to the quotas that the liberals want. No end to them. It becomes absolutely absurd. You know, people just say, "My God, what are we doing?" And there was enough people in the world that said, "Oh my God, this is just too much. I can see where it's going, and there's no brakes. They don't have any brakes. Liberalism has no brakes at all. They can't brake. It's just." Infinite quotas forever, you know, that's the answer. That'll fixate us, save us from the peace of God. And the same thing, the conservative barbarians have no brakes either, do they? They say build, structure, tear down this forest, you know, they can't stop, they don't have brakes either. And the Trump card that the liberals play, of course, is, well, the conservatives will destroy the world, the ecosystem, they're destroying it. Well, the liberals are destroying it even more so. They're destroying the mental ecosystem. They're even worse. I mean, they're destroying the emotional ecosystem, the mental ecosystem. So they keep thinking we're just bodies, but we're not. So they're blind to the mental environmental damage that they're doing, which is extreme. It's even worse, or just as bad, if I say it's worse, than the physical environmental damage that the conservatives are doing. The liberals are doing massive spiritual, you know, damaging the spiritual environment of the world to a hideous extent. At least the conservatives can be honest barbarians. They really can be. Many of the saints in history were honest barbarians first. And they suddenly say, oh my gosh, you know, this doesn't work. But they had this honesty in them, which is all important. The liberals are very devious. They don't seem to have any honesty left in them. Very, very devious. Sneaky and devious, because they know that what they have, you don't want it. They want to impose all these quotas on you and structure. That's just structure too. They want to structure your lives. The liberals want to structure the environment. The liberals want to structure your inner environment. Same coin. two sides of the same coin. So when you see that, you give the whole thing up. So, I mean, I give up the entire world. So obviously I'm not pro or con any side. If you surrender the entire world as one, all at once, that means you are not fixated or supportive of any particular faction at all. Really? Of course not. But certainly pragmatically, I'm aware of the checks and balances that if you don't have those, then you're really going to get in more trouble than you deserve, okay? You don't want that. So it was a godsend. It was a godsend that we didn't get more liberal power, you know, control. It was a godsend. And Trump's now undoing a lot of that stuff. Which is a godsend, actually. And people don't realize that. The liberals don't realize that. They think that's throwing them into the jaws of an abyss. Because their defenses against the peace of God are being dismantled. So, of course, it's freaking them out. And they're going to get into massive sex, drugs, and rock and roll. There's no... And protests and everything. No question about it. You know, impeach Trump. They got nowhere to go except that. That's why I say, the suburb, look out. There's like these meetings are being held in cities now in the Bay Area. They're holding now town meetings to come upon. They're coming to draft articles of impeachment for Trump, and they're already. I think the city Alameda drafted an official resolution of Alameda, an official resolution for the city of Alameda that Trump must be impeached, articles of impeachment or something. That they've come up with that now. So that's what they're doing in California. That's how scared they are. I mean, just, you know, cuckoo. But fortunately, you know, Trump isn't paying any attention to that. Because it's going, you know, the balance is going back. And so we're trying to, the oscillation like this is necessary in the world between these two factions, these two maniac factions. They're both maniacs. Both maniacs, okay. Serious. Trump's a maniac, of course he is. But so are all the liberals. They're just as maniacs, if not more maniacs, than Trump. That's absolutely clear. They just believe in, you know, total inner structure. We've got to structure the inner. Once we structure the inner structure right, the outer structure will snap in place. That'll all be good too. And they call that the kingdom of heaven. And in this world, they think we have to build the kingdom of heaven here in this world. We just got to get our inner structure right. That's nonsense. That's absolute nonsense. Peace of God has no structure at all. That's what we really... Jesus said, this isn't my world. I didn't come to save the world. I came to, you know, bring a sword. I didn't bring, you know, to free you from the world. To free you from this nonsense of hallucinating the absence of God. So, yeah, the liberals are maniacs. There's no question about it. Absolute maniacs. As are the conservatives, too. They're both maniacs. But there's a different... But they're also... Within conservatism and liberalism, there are those who want to leave that and want to go independent. And that's what I did. I left both. I became independent. So, you're going to be identified as one or the other. So, don't think that I'm criticizing you. Or don't take it the wrong way. There is a way out of that. There is a way out of it. Is to see both are equal maniacs. It's two sides of one coin of insanity, actually. And you can't make insanity true and then fix it. Okay, that's not possible. In other words, you can't make the peace of God truly an abyss and then reestablish the peace of God, which is what they're trying to do. These maniacs are trying to do that. They say the peace of God is an abyss, but we can establish true peace of God here in this world, you know, like that. That's insanity. Because the peace of God, what it is it's everywhere. It always has been everywhere. And they're saying, no, it's nowhere, but we're going to create it here in this world. That's madness. That's being maniacs. Complete insanity. As Jesus says, you can't make illusions true, okay, and then fix them, and fix it. So work towards this independence. Work towards being, I am an apex yogin, the peace of God. God is wowing me. I am an apex yogin, the peace of God is wowing me. I'm wowed by the peace of God. I'm being wowed. The peace of God is wowing me. I'm wowed. I'm an apex yogin, wowed by the peace of God. I'm an apex yogin, wowed by the peace of God. Something like that. I'm an apex yogin, and the peace of God is wowing me. Peace of God, and I'm apex yogin, and the peace of God is wowing me. That's the only place to go. When you become independent, the only place to go, really, is towards this apex yoga, really. The bridge. The bridge is the only place to go. You now realize that the only option is to cross this bridge, have this bridge identity of wow. Otherwise, you'll just oscillate. And you see, just being independent without going across this bridge, you're still totally vulnerable. And what you do then is you try to control this oscillation and manage the oscillation between these two maniacs. And this just constantly pulls you into just overwhelming considerations, and you just have a mental breakdown is what you have. So don't fixate on being independent. Independent is just the opportunity to step onto the bridge. But if you don't step onto the bridge and start crossing the bridge of wow, the bridge of wow, then you are going to be sucked into trying to manage the maniacs as if that's the answer. And that's, then you really will get broken by that. You will feel ostracized and alienated and bitter and overwhelmed. Let God handle the oscillations, okay? Somehow the grace of God knew that we needed to pivot back, we needed to oscillate, prevent fixation from the liberal maniacs. So somehow God brought in Trump to the world, and he was able to get elected. I don't know how, you know, is amazing. Just there's no way to even explain it, really. Of course, the liberals say, he cheated, he did it, you know, because they say, that's not right. Our defenses against the peace of God are being destroyed. He's going to kill us all. You know, it's the end of the world. Really, the liberals, maniacs, believe it's the end of the world. They really believe that. They're more end-timist than anyone else. They think the world's about ready to be destroyed. It's all coming to an end. So Trump mopped at all costs. You know, this is what they believe. No, it's just their defenses against the peace of that are being melted down to a certain degree. Still powerful defenses, but the fine edge is being taken off those defenses. The fine edge is being taken off the defense. So now they're being plummeting back into the fear, and then they'll start self-meditating the fear, which is the one way they do it. It's through also disobedience and protests and sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Same thing. This is what happens. And the women become super promiscuous, because they're trying to also treat their self-medicate, you know. And so they pull the men into, you know, the sex, the drugs, the rock and roll, the protest, the emotion. You know, they become like this. It's horrible. Get away from the women. At this time, it's the women that pull you into it, pull the men into it. Absolutely. Because women always drive the stronger than the men. And for women, as soon as they see it as a matter of survival, they're going to be a not do this, then they become very hyper-emotionalized about it. And men have a difficult time dealing with this. Almost impossible to deal with it. It's like in the pagan, when they wanted war, they became hyper-emotionalized. And all the men went off to battle and got slaughtered, or they couldn't resist. The women would stand behind them in battle, and all tattooed up and all in a frenzy, screaming, and to the men, and the men didn't dare retreat, because the women would tear them to pieces. The men were way more frightened of their women than the men of the other tribe they're trying to in battle. Way more frightened. So on a battlefield, there's honor among men, you know? It really is. And the men don't really hate the ones they're fighting at all. They just say, well, the women want us to fight. If we don't, we're going to be torn to pieces. We're terrified. So we got to do this. And the other men will say, yeah, same. You know, they say it's a matter of survival, so we got no choice. But the men, we don't really hate each other the way we're in a fight with one another. And no, we'd much rather just set down our weapons and play baseball or something. Throw play, you know. We don't want to be at each other's throats, not at all. It's the women that put us at one another's throats, actually, because they say this is a matter of survival, and which means our defense, the fear of the peace of God, must prevail against their defenses. Don't work. We know ours will work. And if they prevail, we're going to lose our defenses and we'll be. So that's what causes war and conflict. And it comes women. You know, then trigger. Men get all triggered and all hyped up. And then, and they're so afraid of the women. Because women meant the mother, of course. And the mother, of course, they infantize the child, men, if they want to have war as men. And then, of course, like a child in relation to the mother feels he's got no choice to. He's more afraid of the mother than he is being his brother over there. That's a fact. So for men, women is very important at this juncture. Very, very important. Because remember how beautiful and nice they are. If they're not an ex-yogin, they're maniacs, driven by this extreme fear of an abyss. Half the peace of God is present everywhere. You can't get rid of it. And so they believe that abyss is there. They keep looking within. Oh my God, it's still there. Become maniacs. If those the abyss of God, that the peace of God is an abyss, have no choice. Maniacal side to them. So even the most docile person, if they've not repented and not gotten the real path of the bridge of wow, underneath they're a maniac. They can flip a switch and become maniacs just like that. I don't care who it is. The most rational person in the world can become a maniac if the right kind of emotional pressure is. Absolutely, this is so. That's why the liberals are stupid to try to torment. The right way to do it is to say, okay, they should go back and say, okay, every dog has its day, and they should looking to the future and can we get power back like that, instead of trying to torment him, because again, any maniac, liberal or conservative, who has not yet seen this issue of hallucination, spiritual mind has not been awakened, whose spiritual awareness has not been truly awakened, is a maniac, has this maniac capacity. And if you torment them too much, you can flip them over into that. Actually, you can. And then, you know, you get whether it's conservative or liberal. So you don't want about Trump being Adolf Hitler. Well, they can turn him into that if they keep tormenting him, trying. Absolutely, they're stupid. They don't even know what they're doing. Torment anyone here, okay? Religion is to try to avoid this torment. Okay, love one another. Try to torment one another. Love one another. Forgive one another. Kindness. This prevents the world into chaotic, really turmoil. Okay. And then this helps us then become more into all that. And it helps us get on the bridge of wow. See clearly, oh, the apex approach, this actually works. And the peace of God is not in a bit. Whereas if the world is constantly oscillating in battle, how do you do that? It's really difficult. So really, there should be love-ins for Trump to help him realize, don't into maniac mode. Liberals are so stupid. They don't even see that. They're trying to get him into maniac mode so they can impeach him. What idiots. No, it's better that you play golf, you know, and he's the edge off of the insanity of liberalism, so that, you know, it stays staying like this and doesn't get fixing one direction too badly to do it. I mean, we let the previous president do his thing for the most part. So hopefully it doesn't go too far. It didn't. He took the edge off some stuff of conservatives, which needed to be done. Didn't disagree with that. That edge, okay, did a good job of that, okay? So now we have Trump coming in. He needs to job of backing away from the edge of liberalism, the insanity of that. Take the edge off that. We remain breathing, you know, breathing here, so that we can actually pay attention to the gurus, you know, to the Dharma kings. This, don't hate on people, can flip you over, especially those who want to hate on them. You could growl. I mean, I'm sure I was, you know, hopefully wouldn't get re-election. He did. To keep taking place. And then I said, okay, good, but we need, you know, to make a change. And we did. It's all good. It's all good. And maybe I would play golf. Because actually, you know, he did a good thing to be done. But he needs to just sit now and play golf. Okay. And see the... those who are trying to torment Trump. He just needs to, if he doesn't back off, then he's an idiot. Okay? All presidents have always backed off when they're done. They did their thing, got their wisdom, say, okay, and let the next one do his thing. So he needs to just shut up and play golf. I'll play golf with him. Maybe that's what he needs. That's what he needs. Maybe I'll go down to Palm Desert and play golf with him. Why not? Maybe that's what he needs. But as far as, he didn't do a bad job as far on the edge of it, what previous President Bush was, you know, he was putting an edge on structure too much, you know, it was going that. So he then, previous next president, the edge off of that, right? Spun it back the other way. And now Trump is now spinning it back. And that's how it has to happen. As long as we fear, believe the peace of God is an abyss, that's what we have to do. We have to oscillate and do. But nations can become much less severe of those in the world turn to the peace of God, turn to the apex. My apex is wowing me. I'm being wowed by the peace of God. I'm being wowed by the peace of God. I'm an apex wowed by the peace of God. The more that turns this, tense the oscillations need to be. And everybody looks away from all of that structuring. Okay? We don't need to. Don't need so much structure. We're self-contained internally and internally, because the peace of God is not an abyss. But you have to wow it. You cannot structure it. You have to wow it. The wow is a 360-degree-ness of Venus. And that's it. There's no other definite. It's just that. It's just that. So if tormented, he'll be fine. He'll be fine. Edge off of liberal defenses. If they just go completely crazy, then it might turn out bad, real bad, possible, right? Pretty tough. He hasn't yet. He's got a capability to not. But that, you know, maybe you don't want to push your luck. You know, you don't want to press your luck with somebody's got their. You don't want to press your luck. You don't want to try and. If all you want to do is antagonize somebody, they break, which is what happens when your defenses against are being dissolved, and you have no spirit, then you feel like you need to defeat this person, and you do is turn them into a maniac, so you feel you're justified to get. Happens. This is history. This is how history. So some liberals have wisdom to just say, huh, nah, and just, okay. Just like some conservatives have wisdom and grasp, right? And they prayed to God. They prayed to God, God, please, you know, we need. So maybe the liberals should pray to God instead of trying to and oscillate back the other way at some point. But what they really should be praying for, of course, is wisdom. Again, praying to God to protect you from the peace of God, that's not very productive. It is prayer, and God does oscillation, yes. It doesn't go anywhere, so it's very unproductive. You want your prayer to be more meaningful than that. A couple of sessions of trampoline yesterday, this morning, it's like, wow, I'll take that. Yeah, I got a little sore yesterday, but far it's so I'll do some more trampoline. I can feel it really is thing. And if you don't have time, one of those small trampolines, what is it about, you know, it's this diameter is about 3.5 feet or so. Three and a half feet by diameter. So this is a little trampoline. The caveat trampoline is, there's a caveat, of course, right? Is you have to have a strong core before you start doing this, or you're gonna your lower back. You're gonna hurt your lower, and it'll go out on you. The muscles up on, will spasm up on you, and you'll get real lower back aches. So you really have to work your core first. Core, the first work you need to do in fitness. It's the first work. And we'll engage your core. Like when I'm on the trampoline, I'm engaging my core, consciously keeping it tight. Be able to engage your core. You have to be able to feel your core. Your core there to engage. If it's just completely flabby in your strength at all, you can't even feel that you're engaging it. So you really need to work on it. And that's difficult. I'd say spend a year. Once you do that, then you could do the trampoline work. You can do other stuff. And you're not going to injure yourself. You're not going to have back problems. Because back dead in your tracks, won't they? Absolutely will. So it's super important to do this bending and twisting and, you know, leg lifting and all the kind of the ball, like law and moving in different directions on exercise ball that make you keep engaging your core, force you to engage your core. Whatever exercise forces you to engage your core, I'm losing my balance, this, but I gotta tighten these muscles. I'm like, those kind of exercises over a period will really strengthen your core. Then you find you're able to engage your core, everything you do. Like if I'm carrying heavy loads, like trying to let my shoulder and arms do the work. Oh, it's amazing how I forget, oh, this is heavy. I use my strength of my shoulder and arm, and I forget to engage my core. Wait a minute, let me tighten my core. Let me contract my core, make it strong. And then instantly I do that, and the load feels very light, very light. That's why you say all that stuff. They have very strong cores, because every day they're bending, lifting, stuff. Their cores are really strong. So they're just automatically, they're engaging their cores, and they're able to carry all the stuff. That's how, day after day, you're going to injure yourself if you don't engage your core. Same thing on the spiritual. You do core work, which is this apex yoga pre-intensive. It's just doing the core work. It's getting hearing this, what I'm saying, that throws you off in balance, and it will engage your core. After doing that enough, you can just keep stay stable. And then you're able to look at this. I can see it now. I'm seeing history, how it really works, and politics and stuff. So for men, I'd say stay away from women. Simple, stay away from women. That's the first and best step. Now, your wife, you're used to, okay? And if you have a mutual respect there, if you've been putting, hey, look, I need time for myself to remain stable, and I'm going to remain stable, the woman stable. And if you're fortunate, I'm blessed, and that sort of, you know, I just say, this is what will work for me, and so do. And so if you're blessed and you're very fortunate, you have a spouse like that. You're a woman, you have a husband or spouse or significant other, you're working the same thing. I have to, from maniac mode, you know, myself, I realize there's potential for maniac mode. I don't want that. disaster for everyone. So you say to your spouse, hey, you need to be protected from me, and my doing this meditation and apex yoga helps from me, because if I switch into maniac mode, you're going to, for sure, almost for sure, or we're going to split, one of the two. No fury like a woman scorned, that's a truism, meaning feel that their defenses against their fear of the abyss, if their defenses are getting, then there's nobody who's more proactive than women. They're the most proactive by far. Hell hath no fury like a woman, very true. So times, when times are like this, space from women. And women, make sure you have space from yourself. Or make sure that your husband is sniffing the base from you. That's called a wise woman. Because you might go off a few times. That doesn't get them. Because it will really... You might go into maniac mode occasionally. And a wise away from their spouses when they're like that. Those are women. Women can be wise. There are a lot of wise women. They get it. You know, they say, wow, I can just devastate the male. Push him into something he doesn't want to get into and shouldn't. I just got to calm down and stay away from one like this and just say, no, stay away from me for now. Let me calm down. It's a wise woman. And the world needs all wise. Absolutely. But less and less of wise women in the world. There really are. Wise women in the world does not remain stable at all. It became chaotic, turmoil, severe war and conflict. Because the wise go into maniac mode at some point, and then the men just collapse, capitulate to it, and become, you know, we'll protect our defenses. And whoa, no, wait a minute, we don't even need those defenses. Let's accept this wow as our bridge identity. The egoic identity is empty. I surrendered everything from it. It's just an empty rice shell. Okay, husk, just a husk. It's still there, but it's just a husk. The wow identity, the bridge identity, is here now, and I'm feeling it 360 is real strong. I'm functioning great in the wow identity, but way better than I did in the I identity. The I identity is a husk. Now I have the wow identity, and that bridges me to wowed by the peace of God. It's that simple, and that's the option we have, really. The only option we have. It's just like that. So we can all step away from the brink, which we're headed towards the brink. The liberals are organizing to try torment Trump into maniac mode, so that then they rally everybody to get rid of him, to depose him, and so they can get us back. That's what they're after. Instead of having enough wisdom, and maybe this is just a correction. Okay, let me stay with God. Let me see if I can find some way to not go into maniac mode, because I know that's not good. It's something's telling me, a little voice inside of me is telling me, that's not right. That's not right. So, in the abyss. So, we'll see what happens. I'll invite Trump to play off too. If he's getting tormented, I'll say, hey. And we'll have a great time, and you'll cool down. The president cooled down. You cannot try to flip the president out. That's... You don't want to flip someone out who's in charge and has the power. You do not. You want to stay on their good side. You want to stay, because barbarians are capable of wisdom. I mean, just, well, liberals are barbarians too. You know, just different structuring efforts. They're capable of grace and wisdom. And backing away. Absolutely. All my interactions have been with maniacs in the world, and back away temporarily. But when the women tell go fight, then they'll go fight, for sure. So away from it is the most important thing. It is the most important thing. But by allowing their men to get away from them, okay, if you're a wise woman, you should be encouraging men to stay in as much as possible right now. He said, you know, you need a break from me. You really need a break from me. That's a brilliant one, and you're really saving the world by doing that. You're doing super great help, actually. But without that, chaos is coming, turmoil is coming, without that. So if you're a woman, it starts there. starts arguing, and the women's the home, the woman was saying, you know, man, go play golf. Go play golf. Just get away from me, okay? I'm feeling this maniac mode. My senses are melting down, and I'm feeling really jittery, and it's a maniac mode, and you don't want to be around me because I'll do damage. Do damage to your psyche, the relationship, everything. Alienated, and you'll feel, get into warrior mode. I don't want that. That's wrong. Grace of God is telling me that's wrong. Grace of God is informing women right now, is saying, guys, get away from women right now. Get away from them. Get away from them. That's what happened last night in the hand of God. Last night, and shook me up, stopped me, and said, stay away from Facebook. Stay away from Facebook. Because Facebook is not really, as far as those who friend you, and the troll by maniac women. They can't get away from women. And so I need to stay away from that. I need to stay away from women. Absolutely. The wise women, and there are some out there giving me my space very much. Very wise. Helping save the world, actually. You know, lead, follow, or stay out of the way. So I've noticed there are some wise women who just, and from me, and just say, you know, give me my space. I realize that. I recognize that. I say, they're listening, you know, they're aware of the landscape. They're aware of the dynamic. That is fantastic. But really, in cultures that are wiser, a lot of women are that way. You don't want to spend too much time with me. It's good for you. It's not so good for you. You need to have your own strength. You know, I can easily tear you down. Piece of cake for me. And sometimes I feel like doing that. So the thing where you can get away from me when I'm that way, that's tremendous woman right there. And women should have that wisdom. It needs women to have that wisdom. It's aware of the power of women. Have to have the wisdom to say, when I go a little maniac, I'll be able to head for the hills. Okay? You have to be. And I know you'll come back. And when I, then I'll say, hey, it's okay. It's safe to come back. And you'll come back. And that's how the relationship between men will be. To effectively, ultimately, insane belief that the peace of God's an abyss. Which is, we're all gripped by. Why we're in such so we have it all worked out here. Facebook, it's just, I mean, you get women every angle. You can't believe it. From the lowest sleazy stuff to the most flowery stuff. What you need to do, the answer for you is to hang out. And it's never the answer for men to just spend all their time hanging. Never the answer. And vice versa. That's never the answer. Relationships are never the answer, actually. It's the peace of God is the answer. Relationships, special relationships, is just a defense. It's the fear that the peace of God's an abyss. It's just a defense against. And it's interesting. Another thing, I've never really been that interested. Never been that interested. No value. There's no value there. No value. It's not the peace of God. It's a defense against it. It's like a nanny state. Big mother. It's men are supposed to spend time, you know, like with all these women, like constantly, you know, pecking on them, watching everything move and every thought. Need to bring about disaster in the world. Men need to get away from the women, feel that they have their own sphere where they, and women don't intrude upon that sphere. That's why feminism is brought about this disaster that we have right now. Get away from women anymore. It's not possible. Whatever men want to do that too, and you have to let us do it. You have to let us do that. Men, they want to go surfing and just get a, that's one of the women, you know, don't really much. They can get away from. Women are now insisting, no, we need to have our tour. We need to be paid. We need to surf with you guys. So when men, that sphere of this is how we can get away. Skateboarding is not, women have trouble, but even then, they're pushing into that too. So you need to push into that so you can regulate them. The liberal belief that everyone has to be regulated. Their every thought, every action, everything. So got their own thing out there. We can't regulate them. So you have to them and so they can be regulated. And this has brought about trouble now where men cannot protect themselves when women, which will cause world war. So feminism really is what it's really all about. That's a fact. It's seen. That's why it's so terrible. Wise women, they'll have their thing, but they say, guys, you do your thing. perfectly all right with us, don't you two? And men need to hear that. Say, women have to tell them, look, we want you, if you go do that, you golf together, we want you to do that. It's okay with, you need to do that. Then the men can relax. Otherwise, their wives, they can't really relax. That's just a wise society structure that way. We don't need to know what you're doing, forget it. There's this, last week, he was going to this lunch. Are the wives coming? He says, no, it's stag. It's all men. We just want to get away from our wives. Yeah, totally okay with that. I said, yeah, get away from me. It's good for you. Right there. She's a wise woman. I feel that. She understands that she gets a little cuckoo at times. She knows that. She's and says, you know what? You need to get away from me for a while. That's good. That keeps peace in the world. With very clearly here, that peace will not last in the world. The Fraulein syndrome. We've got to, the always have her hovering around you. You know, like thought and motion, stuff like that. And then the man, when she goes to maniac mode, has no defenses against it. He can go nowhere to run, nowhere to hide, and he's flipped over into an officer or a Nazi. That's what happens. That's absolutely what happens. I always said the Fraulein are what created Nazi Germany. They didn't give men enough space, you know? They wanted to be involved in their lives. Where the men just couldn't get away and just loaf. Make it easy, just go play golf. And talk about how nice it is to get away from the suffocation of women. And vent and feel like, they have some defense against maniac mode. It's essential. That's why they have these men's clubs. And wise women say, go have your men's clubs. You know, they're non-feminist, wisest. For sure. The feminists are dangerously stupid. There's danger in the world. They've brought about the situation now. A lot due to drugs. I mean, drugs make you really, really stupid. Most wise women in the world have done drugs. They don't do drugs. They don't get into that. No. I got to watch myself carefully, They understand the power that they have. And they know if they use it, it's a disaster for the world. That's a wise woman. Wise women. And therefore, they got to protect men from themselves. They go maniac. They said, you guys need to be strong enough to spike a little crazy. That's the world is, actually. Of course, women have more power than men in this world. That's the way it is. So to keep producing bodies, to survive, to keep the defenses going, that's ground zero in all of that. Women are ground zero in defense, fear of an abyss. So they have the power, the authority to say, hey, guys, this is what we have to do. Otherwise, I won't be able to have more kids and all defense lapse. So you've got to listen to me. And the men have no argument for this if they're not spiritually wise within that. So generally speaking, conservative women are better. I mean, they need, you need your space from us. They come from, and the liberal women have pretty much abandoned wisdom culture and thinking that, just super regulation everyone and then sex, very promiscuous, and they become very nice at that point. Generally, it generally breaks down that way, but not our. There are anomalies in that too. I mean, sort of women that are terrible. Absolutely. Freaks. Absolutely, that is true. So that's the indicator. Those who kind of have conservative wisdom but are not control freaks like that. So they don't have any problem. You say, I need to get away. They say, it's no problem. And there are strong men who say, yeah, fine. Take a break from Facebook. Stay away from it. On the other hand, Jesus says, out of the wisdom, wherever, but that doesn't seem to be right now. if it only attracts women, that's no good. Only a lunatic would try to build up this posse of women. That's stupid. That's really stupid. Trying to help men get away from women. That's what they're gonna be the killers, the maniacs, the pit bulls. You get the man in the world. And if he's not himself against women, he's going to be turned into like a Goebbels or Dr. Mengele or You know, he's going to turn an SS officer, and he's going to be a super wicked person. No doubt about it. Those Nazi higher-ups, they couldn't get away from women. None of them could. None of them could. They're wimps. They were crushed. But without mania, they would be very nice people. But Fraulein's going into maniac mode. They became monsters. So you take the nicest man how to defend himself against women, maniac mode of women. This is how it is here. So the real thing, spiritual wisdom, is to protect themselves from women. And the wise way can help by saying, yeah, do that. Do that. Go to be an apex yogin, please. Be protected from me, because I might flip into maniac mode. In fact, I will at times. Sometimes. Every woman flips in. The idea is to know when to minimize the collateral damage of it. Okay. Minimize the collateral damage of it. So wise women create these, help these religions arise. Go do this, because this will minimize the collateral damage. It does. And then they know that their lives will be of that. Much better because of that. It has to be structured. That's the only really wise structure there is. So if you're a woman hearing this, you say, you know, guys, be apex yogins. Okay, get into that. I support it. That's great. Just do it. I don't have to be hovering around during everything you do. You know, I don't have to infiltrate it or anything like that. Just go do it. Go do it. Go do it. I want you to succeed at that, because that is really going to minimize collateral in the world in general. The more apex yogins there are, the less collateral damage will be from women flipping into maniac mode and then flipping the maniac mode because they feel that their defenses against it are melting down. Do not unfear that arises when you think your defenses against an abyss of annihilation are melting down. Fear becomes absolutely maniacal. So do not underestimate it. So it's really the women standing up and saying, no, guy, notice, you don't need an X number of women. You need a place where you can get away from the women, actually. To mess with that, because if we do, we're playing with fire. And the guys aren't bad. You know, you're playing golf. They're so nice, civilized. They're such gentlemen. But what if, like, boy, fine. Then not a problem. As soon as the woman enters, problems arise. If she gets in maniac mode, I'm going to have to do what she says. It's just like that. The wise woman will say, hey, hi, their husband. Oh, you're with the guy. How you doing? Hi, guys. You guys have fun, okay? She leaves. And the other guys, they relax like that. But the woman, immediately, they're all tense and nervous, like, uh-oh. She'll monitor us and, you know, subvert the whole thing. Immediately shifts. That's why I say in apex yoga, they should have the men separate and the women separate. Don't mix the two. Religion it has been largely that way. Because religion is largely just have defenses against women's maniac mode. And women know that. And so it's helpful for all society. Women go about it in exactly the same way as men, actually. In terms of rituals, all this kind of stuff. That just is something for men to get away from, you know. And the collateral damage. That's really what it's about, men like that. They can do it, you know, just by being, meditating, being quiet, and letting everything settle. They're really capable of doing it like that. Men that need the religion more than the women. So that's why I say women should stay out of religion. They're not being blocked from religion at all. Women, non-dual, they tend to be at that in terms of just let everything settle. They can do that. But the men need the defenses against, and the women need that too, to prevent damage when women go into maniac mode, which is very destructive. Very, very destructive. Again, we'll do that. It's, don't underestimate. Don't underestimate it. So, but the laws, I mean, you know, the structure is quota, 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 or else you're sexist or something. This is really stupid. It is super destructive to society. Super, super, super duper destructive. We need to go back to a way more traditional setup. Where the women are supportive of the guys doing the religion things. I think that's great. You need that. Because I don't want, the last thing I want is for the men to go into little and be controlled by their, when they go into maniac mode, the women become these juvenile warriors, you know, kill everything, you know, that kind of thing. That's the last that any wise woman wants, the last thing. So the religion protects against that from happening. Difficult for men. I mean, it's not easy to work at it, you know. It's something that they're really obliged to do, actually, and women are obliged to support that. That's part of the obligation here. They're obliged to do religion religiously, and women are very much obliged to support that and say, guys, this is something you got to do. That in itself is not realization. It's stabilize and prevent collateral damage from the worst of it here. And then once that is, things are, then you need to turn to, you know, apex yoga. You have apex. Absolutely. You don't want to just stall out in that. Still work to be done. The guys keep their religion, that's fine. And then do apex yoga, apex yoga. And the women, let maintain your bossiness, your momness, okay? And do yoga. It's just don't boss the men around, okay? Self around. Boss yourself into doing apex yoga. Stay away from the men, or else you'll start getting bossy with them. Which will, you know, ruin your path. Stay away from them. Let you, hey, man, go do your religion thing. Okay, do know anything. You don't really have to know anything about religion, actually. So it's not like women are somehow have been are behind. Really know that much about religion. You don't have to know anything about religion. Women don't have to know anything about religion. That's a male thing. Women, they're maniacal mode. So you're not behind. Women are not. They're not ignorant or something. Never into apex yoga. Just boss yourself into that, into discipline. Discipline. Just surrender the world. Just work on surrendering. You don't have to know any religion. Tell you, well, you have to know all this religious stuff. You just say, no. See, this is very liberating right here. You don't have to listen to men religiously, and you got to learn all this religious stuff. No, you don't. Is this still taping? You don't have to learn any of that stuff. So why hang out, infiltrate the religions, and learn all this, and take them over, and say, okay, how do we do this? Nonsense. Absolutely stupid nonsense. They're not getting the prize through religion, so you're not missing out on the prize at all. The prize is the wow identity. That's the prize. It allows you then to experience, to be wowed by the peace of God. That's the only prize. And that has nothing to do with religion, actually. So it'd be wise enough. They're just defenses against a woman maniac mode. That's all it is. That's all that it is. Just see it that way and say, that's good. Don't try to tear men down. Just say, good. Keep doing that, guys. But I don't have to do that, which is true. Women don't have to do religion. They support it, but they don't have to do it. They have to support the men that is good for you. But women themselves, they don't have to do religion. They don't. They can just do identity. Just go to the Y identity without religion. Choose my identity is now the wow identity. I am. Identity is my identity. You say, what's the other identity, which is the wow identity? The I identity is just this empty husk. The world to God, everything. So it's an empty husk. I also have this wow identity, and then I have identity as the peace of God. So I have this transitional bridge identity of wow, experience the peace of God, and then just start experiencing the peace of God. Don't compete with men. There's no reason to it whatsoever. Don't compete. There's no reason to. Just work on the world. Just work. Surrender the world. That's it. The peace of God. All right. You don't have to go the way of God at all. And men don't have to go the way the women are going. They don't have to surrender their religions either. They shouldn't. It's a defense. It's a defensive device designed to minimize the collateral damage do in the world. And it's super important. Insist on it. Now, guys, you need religion. It's good for you. It's good for you. It's good for you. Good for everyone. Very important. That's why they train men and wise about that. And for this competition between men and women at all. At all. Different, very different paths in terms of women can more easily just go direct path without religion. Doesn't mean they're faster at to bother with religion. They do have to settle down and boss themselves, and they are prone to going into maniac mode again. And that, you know, so that's their up and down, up and down. They've got it. They're really, oh, I really got it. And then I lost it. I got it. Boom, I lost it. That's what women can do. Okay. So it's more erratic, and they have trouble like this. They think, oh my gosh, I've got it. So I turned into a maniac and I completely lost it. So they have, you know, their own discipline of continually coming back, smoothing it out. As men, in getting to the peace of God. Absolutely. And we don't need to say one is more successful than the other, because it's really not true. It's really not. It's just a very different styles. Now, right now, religion is false. Wise women are saying, oh, shoot, you know, this is really bad. So they should really work on getting to the wow identity right now, because their whole minimizing collateral damage is collapsing. So they realize, oh my gosh, I mean, and terrible, terrible situation. They'd be saying, wow, I really got to just accept the wow identity, surrender the world, and just focus on that. Oblivious to the men in the world. A real wise woman would be oblivious right now. Oblivious. And just be really determined, focused on accepting the wow identity. I'm an apex. I am wowed by the peace of God. I am being wowed by the peace of God. And be oblivious to men right now. Be oblivious. And of course, that'll really help men too. They'll realize, oh, she's oblivious. I mean, good. I can be oblivious to her. Let me focus on my getting past the religion, okay, thing. Getting past that to accepting the trying to lose my religion. I just give it all to God. I need to give all the religion to God. Give it all to God right now. And women, the whole body's control, give that all to God. Give it all to God. Everything. The whole world. The whole enchilada. Give it all to surrender, surrender, surrender. The last thing to acquire something else right now, like women trying to acquire power in religion, that's the worst. That's not surrender. That's the opposite. We should be total right now. Whatever we have, whatever power we have right now, to God, don't be seeking any more power. Wow identity. Accept the wow identity. I'm an apex wow yogin. I am an apex yogin. The peace of God is wowing me. Wow yogin, the peace of God is wowing me. So, perfectly fine. Perfectly fine. Best relationship. If you're gay, be oblivious to these. Be oblivious to them. So that's not an excuse either, right? Whatever the special relationship is for bodies, we're oblivious to bodies at this point, okay? Just work on that. Working on and be oblivious to men. If you're a man, be oblivious to women. And then hang out with them against collateral damage right now. I love Trump, and they'll all be gone in an instant. I might. So would all the guys. the mama's boys are gone. Boom. Those who are controlled by women, they would be gone too. That's provoking them too much. But it's to prevent him from flipping out. Is he there? Well, we don't want him flipping out, do we? No. Is he lovable? Sure, we're all lovable. Does he have? We need to start, you know, loving Trump. Say, Trump, we love you. Don't, you know what? He'd calm down then. He'd calm down. And he'd say, wow. Can't help but feel it. I mean, the people are treating him as if he somehow he's separate from God. We're not, no, we're all an idea in the mind of God. And we never leave that. So of course, if you really show wisdom to somebody, they're going to feel it. Of course they will. And that's going to change their attitude. And they're going to say, okay, let's keep oscillation at a minimum here, okay? Let's not go to extremes, and let's see if we can, all happiness here. The more you more turmoil, the more you love, the less turmoil, like that. City of Campbell can make a proclamation saying, you know, City of Campbell officially declares that we love Trump. Hopefully that's what they're doing. They're calling some big city meeting. And it, you know, and Trump. So hopefully it's we citizens of Campbell love Donald Trump and we wish, you know, nothing but, you know, peace, that the peace of God, we rest in the peace of God at all times. That's a proclamation that all the cities should be proclaiming right now if we really want to be like Nineveh was protected. The king repented. So everybody repent, sackcloth, pray to God for the peace of God be our madness. You know, the king let it, said, yeah, a wretched sinner, I'm a madman. And he was a wise barbarian, but a God came to us and told us what we need to do. Jonah is synonymous with the sign of the whale. In the Bible it says, no sign will be given to at right now, except the sign of the whale, which is Jonah. Meaning Jonah went to Nineveh, and what rocked the city, otherwise in 40 days of destruction will be upon you. And they believed him. No destruction came upon him. So what the Bible's saying is in history, no sign is really given to you except God who come to tell you to repent and bring the wisdom, say, this is what you need to do, everyone. And if you don't do it, you're going to reap the... Sow the wind, you reap the whirlwind in this world. Hate. Try to flip people into... Especially leaders. And you'll reap the whirlwind of your efforts, which is... Again, my advice is to get... You know, I love... No. I'm thinking of doing that in the Bay Area. That'll probably get you... But, yeah, draft, you know, start saying, hey, being wise, okay, in my life, instead of an idiot. And, you know, when you start being wise, you start loving yourself and you start respecting yourself, actually. And then you have even more compassion on yourself. And you say, wow, I have wisdom, and that has value. And so you start valuing yourself. You say, I have value, because I have real wisdom here. I actually have really, really, I have wisdom, and that's really super valuable. And so you start having compassion on yourself, and you gain, and you'll feel better towards yourself. You say, wow, I have some value. I can't just be so easily pushed around by maniacs, you know, and do the wrong thing. No. You start gaining some weight, you know, wisdom starts giving weight to yourself. You get weighty, like, wow. And you it's just a positive spiral that starts happening when you choose to start being wise. So the first thing you might realize hearing this, say, wow, by all means, we don't want to make the goal of trying to turn Trump into a maniac. That is really stupid. Really, really stupid. From everything you've heard here, you realize how history happens. And so the way to do it is send love to everyone. Love and compassion. It's always been done through the wise people throughout history. They preach this. do not antagonize. Send love and compassion to the leaders, to those who are, you know, in leadership roles. Send love and compassion, you know, and greet them with love and compassion. And when you come, go out in public, you know, just, you know, offer them flowers. Say, you know, namaste, peace and love to you. Not in this self-righteous, smarmy way of the liberals tend to do, you know, but genuinely. Says, you know, we love you as a brother, and we just wish the grace and wisdom of God upon you. And genuine. And I genuinely wish all the grace and wisdom and love of God upon Trump, so that he does the right thing. How could you not want that? The maniacs, the liberals in maniac mode, they want him to be an idiot. They wish, like, real total stupidity and idiocy and bad decisions upon him so that we can get rid of him. I mean, how stupid is that? Because people like that are not going to just surrender their leadership. Those who are born to lead, they're not going to just resign. I mean, what are you, crazy? Like that? No way. No way.